recent events in the 20th century couldn't explain this. Therefore, this was sponsored by PCN, as I said earlier, and we're enormously thankful to all of our sponsors because this is kind of thing just doesn't happen without them. Now, the debate between Christianism and Zoom has been pretty turbulent, but also pretty fascinating. We've got an independence referendum, a Brexit referendum, and civil general relations on both sides of the border. But underlying all of these issues is the question of identity. What it is meant, what it's meant to be British, to be English, or to be Scottish. And perhaps the most surprising of these questions is about Englishness, once routinely used interchangeably with British by people not just educated in the world, but internationally as well. But in the first Brexit, post-evolution world, these questions have acquired a certain urgency and a new potency. And nobody has watched these developments more closely than Brian Taylor, the head of columnist, podcaster, and until very recently, the political editor of BBC Scotland. I can't think of anybody more knowledgeable to the place to have an extra family that's been struck down with COVID. Meanwhile, Professor Ailsa Henderson, briefly, she wrote in tandem with fellow academic David Wynne-Jones, is simply called Englishness. So both of these guests have drawn their names in a renewed sense of self, now in common sense across the four nations. And in a moment, I'm going to ask them how they see you on the game playing out in the game of the game. Please welcome Edinburgh University Professor of Politics, Ailsa Henderson, and welcome Broadcaster Brian Taylor. Let's quickly try and start by thinking of this. Some of you for students have said something that comes from your book here. What does that mean to you? So, one thing that we've been interested in is around the use of English national identities at the moment. People want to describe themselves as English, want to them used to. But part of the answer also is about the drop in the proportion of people in English who describe themselves as British. So, this is partly a story about the rise of Englishness and English national identity, but also a drop in the proportion of people who describe themselves as British. And it's not just the rise in identity, although that is in itself is interesting. It's the way that those who describe themselves as English also have a particular interpretation of the state and a particular understanding of England's past, its present, and where England is going. And two things I think are important. First is the sense of Euroscepticism. It's now become quite commonplace to say that Euroscepticism is uniquely English trait. But it's not just Euroscepticism, it's also a profound sense of anxiety and unease with the constitutional status quo within the Union as a whole and England's role within it. So it's a deeper anxiety and dissatisfaction with how things are going, and that dissatisfaction has a particular target, and that target is Scotland, and it manifests itself as a kind of sense that Scotland has more influence than it's been in the majority of America. I don't want to do that, I do want to do that, and yes, but I want to keep comfortable with that. Yeah, there has been quite a change in the way that people routinely don't talk about the foundations in the way that perhaps didn't before, except perhaps in the UK government. And then it was obvious that there was a Scottish and American. What you bring right back in, you physically put what surprising you, because you love to say the good things, saying that being British, a sense of Britishness, matters, means different things to different parts of the country, the whole population in Ireland. So can you elaborate a bit on that?
Yes. Before I was out my headphones, because we have no polling between 2003 and 2011, we just have to guess what happens in between. And the working hypothesis is that it's a combination of Gordon Brown being Prime Minister, which was kind of evocative for those who thought that Scotland had more influence than it should within the Union. Like, oh, we've got the Prime Minister as well. And also the appearance of an SNP administration. And so making things free, which is prompt the reaction from somebody who's electric, hadn't really mattered under the Labour and Labour administration. But it did seem to matter the press reaction when it was an SNP government continuing to make things free. In terms of Britishness meaning different things in different parts of Britain, so the people who describe themselves as English are not demographically or socioeconomically the same as the people who describe themselves as Scottish and Scotland and Welsh. In Wales, and in fact, the people who describe themselves as English in England share more demographically and socioeconomically with the people who describe themselves as British in Scotland. Englishness and Britishness are you would get different types of people describing themselves as English and British south of the border. But the people who describe themselves as English are much more like the people who describe themselves in Scotland as Britishness, as British. And the attitudes are the same. And the best way to think of it is if you prioritize your British identity in England, you voted Remain. And if you prioritize your British identity in Scotland, you tended, which we control for a bunch of other things, you tended to Remain. So Britishness means different things in different parts.
But what you want to write is a different quote for you, because one of the quotes that they say, I hope you both might be at the same with Brexit, was that the substantial number of people in England are British.
Thank you.
for the other reason of that. In terms of citizenship, I'm close to friends, I'm not necessarily in England.
Let me just move to the office, just because I don't remember the name, but it's right at the morning of the referendum. What's funny is that it's the basic way.
Yeah, the first thing that you've examined in the United States is talk about it being English from the United States for English, your roots for English words. And I wonder, first of all, why you think you did that. And secondly, if that would, in some way, solve the rest of the question.
It's also the time of many students of ours, so that's the
The interesting thing about evil in the first English laws is that it was always, you know, every year we did at home, it was always the most popular solution to the governance problem. If you, the first year we didn't include it, and we just had an English parliament, and there was after child support for English parliament, and we were trying to figure out, well, what's going on there, because that's not a moment. And we put in an option for English laws for English laws. It was always the most popular option. The least popular option was always some sort of solution that carved England up into regions, and the thing that called next least to that was the status quo. The status quo was always deeply unpopular. Only thing less popular than the unpopular status quo was carving England into regions. Most popular was always English books for English laws. And after it was introduced, we went back into the field and we were polling people to try and figure out, well, are you happy with what you've got? Most people were unaware that English books for English laws had been introduced. When we informed a certain section of the sample that it had been introduced, and we asked them what they thought, they wanted it to go further. So people weren't aware that it happened, and to the extent they were aware, they wanted it to do more than it was capable of doing. So it was always an administrative solution to what was not an administrative problem. But that also suggests that there's a problem with Brexit there. If there is a demand for change, that change is introduced, and people don't really know what happens, and it has not quelled demand for change, as is the case with evil. It does suggest that there's certain challenges with Brexit if you have the same situation as demand for change, change is introduced, people don't think it's gone far enough.
US, and that's it, nothing else.
Well, that is the challenge, right? Because that, if you just look at the public opinion, the English electorate wants an England wide solution. And we ask all kinds of different ways. We ask them to, you know, pick which governance solution you want most, rank all of these different ones on a scale, you know, whatever. And we also force a choice in terms of what would you prefer, something that treats England as England or something that divides it up. And it's always something that treats England as England. And it's not just the people who prioritize the English identity that I mean that. It's also popular among those who prioritize their British identity. So the English electorate as a whole wants an England-wide solution, but no monarch or monarch state survives that level of asymmetry in their constitution. So it would be deeply destabilizing to the state to have a legislature that is governing for England. But that's the popular option. But the one that is least disruptive in terms of the state dividing it up into regions, or as I keep saying, dividing it into Scotland-sized chunks, because that is the goal, is deeply unpopular to the electorate. So you just keep going around and around in circles.
You've got a constraint in congregating back to you in much as you've got not allowed in this country constituency, which is effectively still what the European Union wants.
Yeah, I know. There is a deep, so that poll was our poll, the one that said, is it worth it to break up the union? And we have two options there. We have, how do you feel about Scottish independence? Worth it to get what I want on Brexit or not worth it? And then we also have something about destabilizing peace in Northern Ireland. And when we stopped polling just in England, we started polling, we now run the State of the Union survey that conducts similar polls in Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. To give a kind of 360-degree review of how people feel about the union, we have to change the question. Because obviously, if you ask that question in Scotland, there'd be loads of people that see Scottish independence has nothing to do with is it worth it or not in Brexit. They just want that as an outright.
Yeah.
But one thing that was always very clear was that people were much more willing to sacrifice peace and Northern Ireland again. There's an ambivalent attitude towards the union in England, and one thing we know is that people are, of the changes they are happy to see, Northern Ireland going is the one that they are most willing to see as a possible change. Above Scottish independence, then it is support for English independence. The least popular in England is Welsh independence. So there is this sense that so long as the Welsh are with us, the union still exists. But we also devise this kind of obviously, supporting independence is a quite radical step from an English electorate's perspective. It calls about 10 we devised a question that allowed us to tap into those more ambivalent attitudes, and we asked people, you know, how do you feel? The union as it stands is a priority for me, I want it to stay as it is. I want independence for my part, or I don't want independence for my part, but two or more other parts, or one or more other parts of the UK decide to go their own way, then so be it. So it's an ambivalent sense. And if you combine the proportion of people who support independence and the ambivalent option, as you just look at the people who have a view, you're at over 50% in every single part of the UK.
Interesting thing about this brand of strength here is that you can use it to go on the
For me, it's fine that there is a massive disconnect. But first of all, it's a disconnect in terms of understanding what the English electorate wants. But it is also a disconnect in terms of understanding the nature of the union. Sometimes it gives me some things. Do they know we're in a multi-level state? Do they know we're in a multi-level state? But for me, it wasn't just the day after the referendum. It was the 2015 Conservative campaign for the UK general election that deliberately exploited territorial fault lines within the union for county gain. The portrayal of, you know, you can't vote Labour because you're going to have to be censored. God, spending all your resources on kinds of posters and puppets and people and pockets and things like that. And at the time, it was like, oh, that's not about Scotland, that's just about the SNP. But actually, after the campaign, those who were involved in the campaign were saying, no, actually, it was just quite convenient because we know the English had the same about Scotland. So we And they quote from someone actually saying, well, you know what we're like, these English, they don't like outsiders governing us. And this notion that, hang on a minute, we're in this thing, we're in this thing, you need to be outsiders. So I think it's not just misunderstanding the electorate, it's strategic decisions about how to exploit fault lines within the union that has been so surprising. But the other thing is that drives me quite mad is the use of the phrase this country by the UK government. And this connects to what Brian was saying earlier. The UK government, both ministers and the civil service are deliberately imprecise about the territorial extent of their policies. They fail to mention when they're governing for England as England, and when they're governing for England and Wales, sometimes it's in the case of injustice, it isn't when they're governing for the whole of the UK. And I had a research assistant. We went through the first 2 months of press conferences around COVID, and they are explicitly making an announcement that has to do with the UK. They mentioned it, about 10 times over the first 2 months. They mentioned it like 3 times if it was an announcement that had to do with England. And often it was because they couldn't get away with it because the thing they were legislating on had England in the title and they had to mention it. To the point where it then had knock-on consequences in terms of how the media reported on it. And then Ofcom had to intervene. And now they say, you're not reflecting the multi-level reality of this union. So it's not just a disconnect about attitudes. It's also a particular understanding of the status quo that isn't quite reflected in its institutional structure.
I want to bring you back to Brian's video. Can you see it for a moment?
Read a book online and they're talking politics. They know the phrase in There's a wonderful Twitter account, That's the Board, which was started by a bunch of undergraduate students at Cove University, and it was also driving them nuts. So they follow various press releases, and they post them and explain one another. And that's, when you say this country, in this instance, this country means this, another Twitter campaign is to say England one. And so they've been decoding every time someone uses the phrase this country, they're saying, well, in this instance, this country means England. In this instance, this country means the UK. In this instance, it means actually England and Wales together.
I would have a different reason for why it couldn't happen in Scotland. The world makes some of the most inventive thinking about the union among unionists right now is occurring within the Welsh Labour Party. We know that there's been a from a much lower base than here, but there has been a substantial public support for independence, labour protests, being insecurities now in Wales. And there's a commission there to look at the constitution. Mark Gifford himself said that his attachment to the union was not unconditional, right? So there's thinking there about the union from a party that in the history of sub-state parties is the most successful sub-state political party in the world. That thinking is not occurring within the Scottish Labour Party. One of the post-mortems, not from the most recent UK election, but like the 2017 one, highlighted that the Scottish Labour had commissioned one vote between the 2015 election and the 2017 election. So there's not the same thinking about, well, hang on a minute, we have this policy. This policy about the union is deeply unpopular with the electorate as a whole. There has been a policy shift in the Scottish electorate. We have not tracked with it. What challenges does that present to us if we wish to retain this as a corner policy? There has not been that reflective thinking. In fact, we wrote, in addition to writing on Englishness and on the Scottish election study, we, after 2017, wrote a piece that was basically Scottish Labour as a case study of party failure, and we went through the literature and said, these are the reasons why parties fail. Which of these explain what the force is going on in Scottish Labour? And partly it's not a case to the leader, partly it's not trusting them in terms of economic policy, but a large part of it is Scotland is failing to track a policy shift that has occurred in the electorate, and there's very little thinking about that in the Scottish Labour Party compared to what we've seen in the world.
Many, many, many studies, because with the Alexander's, they have the 1920s, 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 the 1920s
15 questions. There's a lot of interest in that, right? But I'm kind of telling there's a fair bit move still in Northern Ireland. And part of the problem we have in Northern Ireland with polling, and this is other challenges in Northern Ireland, with the polling, we're less confident in the online polling in Northern Ireland than we are in Scotland. But even with those caveats, I think there's a fair bit of movement still that would need to be seen in Northern Ireland, but that's not happening anytime soon. The other gap, of course, is that Scotland stretches along at 50-50 for a very long time, because one thing, I'm from Canada originally, one thing that is quite clear from looking at Quebec is that you can't idle the engine at 50-50 for a very long time. Something has to change, otherwise it would just change.
That is also because it won't be held unless there is a perception of what a majority would support closing one and having two. That's partly what makes the polling so politicized in Northern Ireland, because the answers to get back to the opinion polls, which for us just before media coverage and something to chat about, are actually, as a candidate of whether there would be a referendum. And that's partly why there is such concern about the gap between what we find when we do close online and what we find when we do the polls face-to-face, because the face-to-face ones happen really rarely. They're so prohibitively expensive. So we have the online ones more frequently. But some, they were grilling one of the online polling firm directors the other day, and he was admitting that they had IP addresses that were the source of sometimes 8, 9, 10 respondents, which seems slightly unusual. So there's something, there's a cause for question around the data.
Thank you.
this number. It's a nice story for the best question.
It's rather easier to identify things that would move it as 50-50 and lead to faster growth in the now numbers, to be honest. So a change in the prime minister, what I need to do is look way down public opinion. Now, we know that in the leadership contest, when Boris Johnson was out, was kind of important to begin with, we know that something like 20% of no voters said that they would immediately switch to yes if it meant that he was prime minister. So we know that part of the argument for independence right now is being made in London and being made no more forcefully than by the prime minister himself. So having a different prime minister would make a difference. Having a different head of the SNP would make a difference because we know that Nicola Sturgeon's individual polling is so popular. We know that having a Labour government in London would make a difference. So it's not just a Conservative government led by a different person, but also a Labour government would turn that down as well. That's not happening anytime soon, though, obviously, because Labour won't find a route to London that doesn't involve winning more seats in Scotland, and that's not happening anytime soon. So that's in terms of turning the dial that way. In terms of the other way, I mean, Brexit, we went looking to see whether anything was happening, both in the immediate aftermath of Brexit and every year since. And the numbers moving from no to yes and yes to no have been roughly canceling each other out since then. But one thing you do notice is that if you look at people who were no, then remain now yes, the demographics of that group are very different from yes support in general. Women are much more likely to be in that group. Younger people are much more likely to be in that group. So it hasn't changed numbers in the aggregate, but it has changed the demographic profile of yes supporters. And that's one of the reasons why if you look at the public opinion figures, we now see the age cohorts who are yes supporting and the age cohorts who are no supporting, that cut line between yes and no is now 10 years on from what it was in 2014. I mean, there is that debate always about life cycle effects in terms of support for change. But what's interesting about that cut point between yes and no is that it's deep into the heavy mortgage territory. It's not the generation that are approaching pensionable, which is the other. So the life cycle effect has different cut points in it, right? Different stages along the way. And the oldest one is about when people are approaching pensions, there's a risk aversion that kicks in about the economic cost of independence. We know about the issue of pensions. And if you move back then, it's different levels of indebtedness in the status quo, economic indebtedness in the status quo. But we're, that cut point between yes and no is deep into the 40s, pushing the 50s. People are wanting to hear. So it's not affecting. Not affecting that aspect of the life cycle change. Well, we don't know what's going to happen. The other thing I would say is it's not just the demographics of yes support that have changed as a result of Brexit, even though it hasn't shifted the numbers. One thing that would make a difference, though, is that definitive statement from the European Union saying no, you'll never get it, or yes, you would get it. And that would move things.
Thank you.
Yes, that is the portrayal of Englishness as the backward looking into the world, being convinced of past success, counterpart to an open and inclusive and pluralistic Britishness, and neither is strictly true. And we're at pains to point that out in the book. There's always been a tension in terms of interpretations of Englishness, but you know, in the interwar period, you could see that tension between Englishness as past success and then Englishness as gentleness. And Englishness has kindness. And you still have that strain, but it is really hard to find. And that's partly what people like John Denham are within the Labour Party are trying to do. It's been a nervousness about the Labour Party engaging with Englishness that has caused it a certain number of problems. And it is because they have also bought into this notion that if you want to portray an open and multicultural and pluralistic society, then the phrase you should use is Britishness rather than Englishness. And I think that's kind of part of the book,
right? So one minute,
Thank you.